Are you stuck on GED math word problems? Well, in this video, I'm going to show you what to do. So in this video, I'm going to give you a 5-step approach that you can use to answer word problems more easily and get more points on your test. Now, some of you might be thinking, won't it be a lot to remember 5 steps? Well, really, all you have to do is remember one word,
FIOS. The F in FIOS stands for find. What is the question asking you to find?
Always make sure you're clear on what the question is asking before you start doing any work.
And the I stands for info, as in what info do you need to solve the question?
There's a difference between information that you're given and information that's actually needed.
Well, the O stands for operation, as in which operation do you need to use, addition, subtraction, multiplication, or division. These cookies we had at my wedding 2 weeks ago would make a great word problem, wouldn't they? I'm just saying. Remember, the O in FIOS stands for operation, but how do you know which one to use?
Fortunately, it's really easy to know what operation you have to use most of the time because there's going to be keywords in the questions, and I'm going to cover these keywords in a future video. So you'll want to make sure you're subscribed so that you don't miss that.
And this brings us to S, which does double duty. The S stands for solve. And sense. You want to solve the question and ask if the answer makes sense.
Need some help with GED writing? Then you're in the right place. Because in this video, I'm going to show you some easily fixable mistakes that GED test takers commonly make with writing. And if you fix them, you're going to boost your score a lot on RLA. So the first common mistake that students make is not writing enough. So on the GED essay, you need to write between 300 to 500 words at minimum. If your essay is significantly shorter, then you can lose points or even get a zero. Tip number two, your topic sentence needs to match the topic of the two passages you're going to read. So for example, if you read two passages where the authors are both trying to convince you of the best age to give kids a cell phone, then your topic sentence must state that. If you write something like, there's a lot of debate around whether or not cell phones should be allowed in schools, then your topic sentence doesn't match the topic. Tip number three, don't write your essay about your personal opinion. You need to read both of the passages and you need to decide which author's position is best supported by the evidence. Tip number four, avoid copying directly out of the passages. Now, to fully maximize your score on the essay, you are going to have to use examples. However, whenever you do this, you need to put your writing in quotes or you've got to restate things in your own words. Tip number five, avoid bringing up new ideas in your conclusion. If you get to your conclusion and all of a sudden you've got all these new ideas, that's a sign that you may need to go back and recheck your body paragraphs. By the time you get to your conclusion, you should have already developed those ideas.
Now, another thing to keep in mind is that you're not going to be able to bring your cell phone or other valuables into you when you go into the testing center. So definitely plan for that ahead of time. Either leave your phone in your car or they'll give you a storage area where you can put your valuables. Now, I've heard that it's just like a little locker that you can put your stuff in, but it does have limited space, so just keep that in mind.
We see this example here, and it's 3 squared. Now, you could also call this 3 raised to the second power, or 3 raised to the power of 2. So there are multiple ways to say the same thing here. But basically, what you have to understand, when you get an expression like this, all right, the 3 is the base, and the exponent is our 2. So what does the exponent tell us? The exponent tells us how many times the base is going to appear in multiplication. So to solve a problem like this, we just have to remember that the exponent tells us how many times the base is going to appear in our multiplication. So since the exponent is 2, that tells us that the base will appear in multiplication twice. So to solve this, we just do 3 times 3, and that's equal to 9. What is a modifier? Well, a modifier, it's a word that modifies another word. So a modifier, it can change, it can add emphasis, or it can add further explanation to a word, and therefore it can change the entire meaning of a sentence. And I should also mention that a modifier, it doesn't just have to be a word, it can also be a phrase. But it's commonly going to be a descriptive word, such as an adjective. So this is best understood with some examples. So what do I really mean by misplaced modifier, though? Well, a misplaced modifier is just a modifier that's not properly paired with the word it's modifying. And as I was saying, this will make more sense as we go through some examples. So example number one is of misplaced adjective. So an adjective, simply put, is just a descriptive word. So in this case, the word cold, which I've bolded and underlined on screen, is our adjective. So consider the sentence here. He drank a cold glass of lemonade. So the word cold, what is it paired with? Well, we see that it's paired with the word glass. So if we read the sentence literally here, what does it really mean? Well, it sounds like it's telling us that the glass itself is cold and not the lemonade. It sounds like it's telling us that the temperature of that glass is cold. So to be grammatically correct here, we'd want to change it to say, he drank a glass of cold lemonade.
So as far as what to bring during the test, you're definitely going to want to bring a photo ID. Now, you'll check on mygeed.com when you make your account to see exactly what you need, but typically this will be your photo ID or your driver's license, or you can also bring a U.S. passport or a foreign passport or a military ID.
So any number raised to the zero power is always going to be equal to 1. For example, let's just pick a random number here. So let's say 99. So what if I said, solve this question here. 99 raised to the power of 0, what's the answer? Well, you just have to remember this general rule here that any number raised to the 0 power is equal to 1.
Tip number 1. Space your 4 GED subject tests out over time. That way you won't have to pay for them all at one time. Tip number 2. Don't buy the calculator. If you're strapped for cash, skip the calculator because you're going to be provided one for free on the computer when you take the test.
Any number raised to the power of 1 is just going to give you the base. All right, so in other words, any base raised to the power of 1 is just equal to the base. Okay, so let's just pick some random numbers here. So let's say 11. So 11 raised to the power of 1. What does that equal? Well, remember from the general rule, any number raised to the power of 1 just gives you that base, right? So if our base is 11 and it's raised to the first power or the power of 1, well, the answer is just gonna be 11.
Also, keep in mind that if you have any trouble during your test at all, just raise your hand, just put your hand up and the test taking center workers will come in and help you. So if you've got a computer issue or something going on where your computer's not working, where you're taking the test, don't try to fix it yourself. Don't waste your time because that timer is gonna keep ticking down and you don't wanna waste that valuable time. Just put your hand up and get help.
First, what is a fraction? A fraction uses two numbers to show a part of a whole. Again, a fraction uses two numbers to show a part of a whole. So in this example here, we see the fraction 7/8, 7 over 8. So there are two numbers in this fraction. The top number is what we call the numerator. The top number here is 7, so the numerator in this fraction is 7. And the bottom number in the fraction is what we call the denominator. So in this example, 8 is our denominator. Again, the denominator is the lower number in the fraction. So one way to remember that is to look at the letter D here. So think of the word downstairs. Both downstairs and denominator start with the letter D. So the denominator, you can think of that as being downstairs. Again, denominator, downstairs. The denominator is the lower number in the fraction. So what is the denominator and what is the numerator and what do they mean? Well, the denominator tells you how many equal parts there are in the whole. And the numerator tells you how many parts of the whole you're working with. The distance is equal to rate times time, and you'll commonly see this written as D equals RT, where D stands for distance, R stands for rate, and T stands for time here. So what are we talking about by distance, and what kind of problems can we solve? So let's say that somebody, they leave their house and they walk down the sidewalk, for example, and they go for a 1 mile walk. So that distance would be 1 mile, or the distance could be if somebody throws a frisbee. So one person throws a frisbee to the other person, the distance would be the distance that the frisbee traveled. So we're just talking about the distance that something or somebody travels, and by rate, we mean the rate at which that person travels, or the rate at which that object travels, and of course the time is just the time it took for that travel to occur. So let's say, like I said, a person leaves their house and they walk a mile, the distance would be the mile, the time would be the time that it took them for the traveling to occur, and then their rate would be the rate that they're moving. So for example, speed is a common rate. So let's look at rates here because it's important that we understand what I mean by rate. So what is a rate, or what does a rate do? Well, a rate compares a quantity to 1. All right, so that's all a rate is. So a rate is just comparing a quantity to 1. And so basically what you want to think of here are, let's look at some common examples of rates so you'll see what I mean. So let's stick with speed. So speed could be, for example, if you're driving down the highway, maybe 65 miles per hour. All right, so 65 miles would be the quantity, and quantity is just a fancy word for for a number or for an amount. So in this case, the quantity would be the miles, so 65 miles per 1 hour. All right, so that's one example of a rate, 65 miles per hour.